All right, welcome everyone. It's my pleasure to call this session to order. I am Alex Sarch, the Director of Research in the School of Law, and it's my pleasure and honor to be able to introduce my colleague, Professor Kenneth Ehrenberg, who'll be giving his inaugural lecture today. I want to say a little bit about Ken. Most of you will probably know him already, but Ken is a powerhouse in the law school and a terrific colleague. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about his background and just make him blush a little bit. Many accomplishments to his name and exciting stuff on the way. So Ken, who's been here for about 5 or 6 years now, since 2017, he's the co-director of the Surrey Center for Law and Philosophy. He is an American, as you'll hear shortly. So he got his law degree from Yale and his PhD from Columbia. And he has taught both law and philosophy at University of Alabama and SUNY Buffalo. And he's been the HLA Hart Visiting Fellow at Oxford as well, so he's gotten around. He has published in very impressive venues. So he's got a book with Oxford University Press from 2016 on the functions of law, where I believe you begin to delve into the sort of artifactual nature of the law there. And I've read not the whole thing, but bits and pieces, and very much enjoyed it. And some of it was over my head, and some of it I fundamentally disagree with, and some of it I agree with quite significantly. Yeah, exactly. So as you can tell, Ken is a wonderful, in addition to being, I'm not going to list his publications in places like philosophy and phenomenological research, and many sort of accomplishments in the traditional way, but I think one of the things that's most notable about Ken is what an energetic and supportive and lovely colleague he is. He's a great interlocutor. He's always ready to go toe-to-toe about whatever question you might be working on. He's very generous with his time, supportive of colleagues, has been very supportive of me, for which I'm grateful, and has helped make my work better on countless occasions. I probably had the reverse effect on your work, I'm sorry to say. But I think without further ado, I'll turn the stage over to you. Ken, congratulations on everything you've accomplished and excited to hear about where you're going onwards. So let's welcome Ken.
The funny thing about that kind of introduction is you're relieved to start speaking because you just wanted to stop. So today I'm actually going to talk about a project that's been kind of in the works for quite a while, and it's what I'm hoping is going to be my second book-length project. Which I titled tentatively Forms of Authority, because the first book was The Functions of Law, so I figured once you do the functions, then you got to go on to the forms or something like that. So it's called The Forms of Authority, and just for today's kind of overview, it's really just an overview of what I'm hoping to accomplish. There's still a lot of work to be done. I haven't really, in any kind of really coordinated way yet, put pen to paper, as it were, or finger to key, as maybe the modern metaphor might be. But the first animating question that starts with any discussion of what we'll call practical authority is, what gives someone the right to tell you what to do? That's really the question. What gives someone else the right to tell you what to do? Another way to put this in a kind of more technical way would be to say, what legitimates practical authority? Right? So let's focus on the question, what gives someone the right to tell you what to do? We're not talking about what gives them the power to make you do what they want. So put aside that, right? We're not talking about power, which is just their ability to get someone else to do what you want them to do. We're looking at the right to tell someone else what to do, and thereby, as we're going to see, give them a reason to do it. We're not talking about what you might call de facto authority, which is a belief that someone has the right to tell you what to do. So I'm not asking under what conditions it makes, you know, that people come to a belief that someone else has the right to tell you what to do. I'm asking what actually gives them that right. So the beliefs can be wrong, and I'm trying to figure out what actually gives someone the right to tell you what to do. And a right, usually but not always, depending on whom you ask, implies a duty. So if someone has a right to tell me what to do, then I have a duty to do it, a moral duty to do it, we would say. Right? If they have a moral right to tell me what to do, then I would have a moral duty to do it. If they merely had the power to make me do what they want, I wouldn't have any moral duty to do what they want. They would just be forcing me in some way. And if I believe that they have a right to tell me what to do, I might believe that I have a duty to do it, but I don't actually have that duty necessarily. So the question is, what actually gives them the right? and thereby potentially gives me a duty to do it. Now, traditional answers to this question usually involve a number of things that give people blanket rights, especially when you're applying this to the state. Right? So traditionally, the answer usually involves, first of all, the divine right of rulers. Right? So you've probably heard from way back when in school, something called the divine right of kings. And that was reasoning from the mere fact that a king was in power, or that a ruler was in power, to the fact that God probably wanted them to be in power and gave them that right to tell you what to do. So one problem with this view is that it reasons from might to right. You have the fact of power, and you reason from the fact of power to the fact that the person has a right to tell you what to do. So that seems a little bit backwards. We'd like to say they should have the power only when they have the right. But also, as you could probably imagine, especially from today's standpoint, it depends on very specific and potentially controversial moves in theology if you're going to talk about divinity. So we can kind of put that one aside. Now, another example comes from, and if you ever read Locke's two treatises of government, has anyone ever read Locke's second treatise of government? That's kind of a very popular one that you study when you're in philosophy or even in political theory, or, you know, people, we kind of grow up on it, some of us in the United States, but what you don't usually read is the first treatise of government. Mm-hmm. And the first treatise of government is actually an argument against this guy named Filmer, who was arguing that the political authority came from parental authority. Basically, it was inherited from Adam. The idea was Adam was the first father, and of course the father has more authority than the mother, I guess. And so all of the parental authority comes to the state over the people as a result of inheriting it from them. So basically Locke had no trouble with this kind of thing and demolished it in the first treatise, and we don't even bother reading the first treatise because he did such a good job demolishing this theory. But so there are many instances where a parent isn't present, and we're not really talking about parental authority. It doesn't seem to be a good model, really, for this state. Now, we will come back to parents because this is about authority in general and not just about the state. But for now, let's put aside parental authority. Finally, perhaps the most famous one that most people know about is the social contract. Maybe the idea would be that someone gets the right to tell you what to do when you have either actively or tacitly made some sort of agreement to do what they told you to do. Right? So, okay, that makes sense to some extent. But the problems with this sort of view is that, I mean, I don't know about you, but I didn't sign any social contract. And most people say, hey, I didn't agree to any of this. And even if I were somehow tacitly taking advantage of the goods that society is giving me, that sort of tacit advantage doesn't imply the kind of perhaps blanket duty to do whatever the state tells you that seems to be the expectation. So contract theory has some problems with itself. Another answer that's a bit more modern, although it has kind of its origins in Plato, is the idea that we owe some debt of fairness or gratitude. We should do what other people tell us to do, especially the state, because we owe our lives to the state. So that's some sort of gratitude. Or in another more potentially more sophisticated version, if everyone else is kind of agreeing and allowing themselves to be bound by the law, then I'm taking advantage of their self-limitation. When they're being bound by the law, that's advantageous for me because it allows me to predict how to navigate my life and how to avoid bumping into people, as it were, when I'm trying to pursue my projects. And so since I get an advantage from other people being bound by the law, then I should similarly, in fairness, be bound by the law in the same way. The problem with this view is that it doesn't really apply to many things. If someone does you a good turn, and the example I like to use with my students is if somebody leaves a PlayStation 4 on your doorstep, right, you don't owe them another PlayStation 4 or something of equal value just because they happen to do that. You owe them a word of thanks, maybe, and maybe a nice, you know, thank you card because it was really an outstanding gift. But that doesn't mean that you owe them something equal to what they gave you. So even if other people are restricting themselves under the law, that doesn't really seem to be a good reason to think that we should ourselves have the same restriction. And so this argument seems like it's not as strong. So more fundamentally, and this is a thing to come away with all of these, what we might call misses, as it were, in the history of trying to answer the question, what gives somebody the right to tell you what to do? There are too many instances where our duty to do what somebody is telling us doesn't depend on our choice. The person getting the duty to do what the other person is telling you doesn't depend on the choice of that person, the person subject to the authority, right? So this suggests that what we're looking for, and I can give you some more reasons to think this way, that what we're looking for is actually, we're looking for something that would be non-voluntaristic. In other words, that we don't have, that we're not volunteering or we're not agreeing to be under that person's authority or something like that. Okay. Right. So there's fundamentally, there are too many instances where it doesn't depend on the choice of the person subject to that authority. So in order to try to get deeper into what authority is and how it can potentially be legitimated, we have to think about the way it operates on us. It seems as though authority operates by giving us reasons that you either didn't already have or that you didn't know about. Right? So authority operates by giving you some either new reasons that you didn't have at all or reasons that you didn't know about. Right? And so we have to think a little bit about reasons for a second. There are at least two kinds of reasons we could be talking about. One kind of reason is what we might call normative reasons, with apologies to Stuart, who said he didn't want to hear me say normative again. normative reasons, which sometimes might also be understood to be real or objective reasons. These are factors that would factor in a good justification for what you're doing, right? If you're trying to justify what you're doing, you appeal to normative reasons or objective reasons, say this is why it's a good idea. That's what we're trying to do. We're trying to understand the way in which somebody telling you what to do could give you a new normative reason that you didn't necessarily already have. The other kind of reason that we're going to kind of sideline is what you might call a motivating reason or a causal reason, right? So we do want our motivations to track those normative reasons. I'm hoping that when I believe I have a reason, I'm getting it right. I'm right about which reason that I have and how much weight to give it. So I want to be motivated by the real reasons or the normative ones. But the motivating reasons are psychological states. And that's not what we're after. We're after an answer to the question of what really gives someone the right to tell you what to do, which is not a psychological state. So an example I use with my students is if you're walking down the street, and as in many cartoons, there's an anvil hurtling out of the building, it's about to hit you on the head, you have a reason to step out of the way of the anvil, even if you never knew about the anvil, right? There is a good reason to step aside because the anvil is about to hit you, and you have that reason even if you never knew about the anvil, right? So that's the example. A lot of furrowed brows, so I'm hoping I'll get questions on that. okay, so in addition to talking about reasons, we have to distinguish two flavors of authority. There's two kinds of authority that we use when we talk about the idea. One is the authority of experts. Experts give us advice and thereby give us reasons to believe what they say is true, right? So an expert will give you advice. Now, you might see something like doctor's orders, right? So the doctor would say, give you a prescription, say doctor's orders, take this medication, you need it for your health and stuff. But in general, we don't think that the doctor is really giving you an order in the sense that they're ordering you to do something. They're telling you what's in your best interest. So they're giving you a reason to believe that this medication would be helpful to your health, right? They're not actually ordering you to do something. And if anything, your reasons for action were already there. Right? You didn't know enough about how the medication could help you. They're giving you that information. You already had a good reason to take that medication if it's true that it'll help you. They're not giving you a new reason to act. They're just giving you a new reason to believe that what they said is true. Does that make sense? You didn't know about it before. Now you get new information. So experts give advice and reasons to believe what they said is true. So any reasons for action that you already had, they are simply alerting you to them. Sometimes, to use the technical lingo, this is called theoretical or epistemic authority. It's theoretical because it's about what to believe, what theories to develop, if you will, or epistemic because that's what, again, what about what knowledge. Epistemology is about knowledge, so it's about an authority over a certain area of knowledge. Another way of distinguishing the two, sometimes we'll say that this kind of authority is an authority on a subject. Right? So to be an authority on a subject is to have expertise on that subject. The other kind of authority, which is the kind we're focused on when we ask the question, what gives someone the right to tell you what to do, is a practical authority. A practical authority is the right to tell other people what to do, right? And thereby giving them a reason to do it. And the one way we make this distinction from the expert is we say that person is in authority over people. Sometimes we might say over a place, but really what we mean when we say someone's in authority over, let's say, London or something like that, we mean over the people in London. We're not saying they have the authority over the actual, you know, land, although perhaps they do that as well, but we're really more concerned with their authority over the people. So to be in authority over the people is to have the ability, the right to tell them what to do, right? Now, it appears to create new reasons that people didn't already have. Appears that when someone actually has a right to tell you what to do, when they tell you to do something, you get a new reason to do that that you didn't already have, because you needed them to tell you to do it before you actually got a reason to do it. Okay? All right. Now, the challenge of autonomy. One of the things that makes it difficult to answer what gives someone the right to tell you what to do is that we usually assume that we're working from a baseline of autonomy, meaning we basically have the right to do whatever we want. We start from that baseline, right? What we're trying to do is understand how to harmonize this intuition we have that everyone starts, you can call it freedom, you can call it autonomy, we have the right to do whatever we want, and somehow someone else getting the right to tell you what to do is a threat or a limitation on that baseline of autonomy. So when we try to unpack autonomy, we might see more ways of understanding how authority could be a sort of exception to that autonomy, right? So one thing is just a fact of life. I mean, we appear always to be choosing our actions, right? Every time we decide how to act, we're making that choice ourselves. So that's like the baseline of autonomy. We are autonomous in that we're always making those actions. And another way to put this is to say that we think that to subjugate our will to that of another, the one reason against that, is that we appear to be avoiding responsibility. We should take responsibility for our actions. And when we subjugate ourselves to somebody else's directions, we are actually giving up our responsibility. We're trying to avoid the responsibility for those actions and put it on the person who's giving us those orders. And that may not be an accurate thing to do, because we're still choosing to do it. If someone gives you an order, at the end of the day, it's up to you to decide whether to follow that order or not. And so you still need to take responsibility for that decision. So autonomy seems to be this baseline that we can't really avoid, right? Now, people give the example of being under a threat. If someone points a gun at you and says, your money or your life or something like that, then you're under a threat, right? And so maybe in that situation, you don't really have any autonomy, you don't really have any choice. Now, I think that's probably overstated. There perhaps are some situations where we psychologically are unable to make choices. We are so overwhelmed by the fear of whatever that threat is that we just almost automatically do whatever will avoid the threat. I'm not denying that's possible. But I think in many cases, there is still a decision-making, a thought process that people engage in, and they assess whatever the threat is to, and they assess the value of whatever's being threatened, and they assess the value of whatever it is that would avoid the threat, and they determine, after making a rational choice, that the value of the thing that you need to sacrifice to avoid the threat is worth less than whatever the threat is, you know, threatening, so to speak, right? So that suggests that you're still making a choice about what's more important to us, right? You're still making a choice about what's more important to you, and so you're still autonomous even when you're faced with a difficult situation. You know, again, maybe money or your life might be an extreme, but there are obviously, you know, other situations where you're not in quite so much threat, or you just have the presence of mind to make the choice for yourself. So one of the upshots might be to say, maybe no one really ever has the right to tell us what to do. Maybe it's just, the answer is nothing. Nothing can give someone the right to tell us what to do. And there are a lot of people who say that. They're called philosophical anarchists, right? So a philosophical anarchist would be someone who is not saying you should go out and, you know, bomb the Houses of Parliament or shut down the government or anything like that. They're just saying nobody ever really has the right to tell you what to do. All they can do is they can basically threaten you and tell you what the bad consequences would be if you don't do what they tell you to do. But it's still up to you at the end of the day to decide, and you're not doing anything wrong if you can avoid doing what they tell you and get away with it, right? So maybe no one ever really has the right to tell us what to do. And those are people saying there's no such thing as legitimate practical authority, and instead it's all just advice about how to avoid those unpleasant consequences. This view, incidentally, interestingly enough, if you think about the different kinds of authority we talked about just about, what, 3 or 4 minutes ago, this reduces practical authority to theoretical authority. It says there's no such thing as practical authority because it's never legitimate. All you're really getting is information. You're getting information about how to avoid those unpleasant consequences. And so, in a sense, the people who are giving you orders are just like experts. They're experts in how you avoid those unpleasant consequences, right? And so it reduces, say, no such thing as practical authority. It's all just theoretical authority. So that's an interesting implication of that. However, and this is the reason to push back, and again, it may be coming somewhat from intuition, and, you know, I mean, the anarchists have a point. If it's all just intuition, then if they've got a great argument against it, then maybe we should just give up those intuitions, right? But it does seem like sometimes we can get new reasons or even new duties from people telling us what to do. Here's one example. I can't remember who, I think it might be Anscombe, but I can't remember exactly where it came up. And she might have been borrowing it from Foot, and I'm not sure, so I'm gonna, I can't attribute it correctly. But let's imagine there's a room, kind of like this room, with two doors, kind of like this room, right? And there are 100 people inside the room, unlike this room, and 100 people outside the room. And as because of some unspecified emergency, you need to get everybody inside the room out and everybody outside the room in at the same time. If you just said, emergency, go, right, what's going to happen? Everyone's going to run to the nearest door, and they're not going to be able to get in or out because everybody will just be crowding at the nearest door, and so you're never going to get everybody in or out, right? If, on the other hand, someone jumps up on the table and says, that's the entrance, that's the exit, loud enough for everyone to hear both inside and the outside, right? In essence, they're giving everyone a directive. They're giving them an order. Use that, and we can change it to make it clearer. It is an order. Everyone use that as the entrance. Everyone use that as the exit, right? Now, all of a sudden, whereas before, you're, because of the emergency, your reason might be to just get to the nearest door. You now have a new reason, even if you're closer to the entrance, being inside the room, to go further to get to the exit, because that's the effective way of solving the problem, right? You didn't have that reason before this person jumped on the table to tell you to do it. So it does seem as though some instances of practical authority, if this is a good example of practical authority, which some people might dispute, some instances of practical authority do give you new reasons for action. We can go even further and use this, and I think a great example is, I mean, we had one just a few years ago, the coronavirus, which is obviously a terrible thing, but it's a great example of how even what you might have thought of as evil regimes or bad governments or, you know, like North Korea or something like that, right? Even governments you would think of having no real political legitimacy, right? In order to be able to respond to an emergency like the coronavirus, they can give orders for people to be, you know, locked down or how to, you know, that they have to be masked when they go outside. And those orders may be legitimate, even though the government is otherwise something that you would think we should do everything we can to overthrow, right? And so the exigency of the situation can actually give legitimacy to some instances of authority, even if that person that we would think of as an authority is somebody we try to get out of authority or get them out of power, at least, in any way we can, right? I wouldn't think the best way, here's another way to put it, even if I'm trying actively to get that person out of power who is an unjust ruler, that interest I have in trying to get rid of them because they're unjust doesn't extend to refusing to obey their coronavirus order, if that makes everybody more unhealthy, right? So that seems like they can still give us reasons for action. So this is a great example, I think, showing that what we want is a non-voluntarist account of when practical authority is legitimate. In other words, we want an account of what gives people the right to tell you what to do that does not depend on us agreeing to it as the people who are subject to that authority. We should agree or do something to show that we agree. Because even when we are not giving them our consent, there can be situations in which they have the right to tell us what to do. And they give us reasons for action and not for just relief. And this is another important point, it doesn't appear that what we need or even want is an account that covers everything they tell us. Right? If we think that, you know, the rulers of North Korea had the right to tell their population to do lockdown and to wear masks during coronavirus, right? We think they have that right, even and that everyone had a duty to do it, even though they don't have the right to tell, let's say, the population to do many of the other things they tell them. So that suggests that what we're looking for is a description of what legitimates authority that operates in a piecemeal way, right? In other words, it operates on some orders and not on other orders. Some orders will be legitimate, some orders will not be legitimate. Some orders will be legitimate for me and not for you. Some orders will be legitimate for me now, but not in 10 minutes, right? A piecemeal account of authority would tell you what makes a given order, or what makes a given directive legitimate, and thereby giving me a duty to follow it, or at least a reason to follow it, at any given time for any given person. And that can change from person to person and from time to time. So we want a piecemeal, non-voluntarist account of authority, and those of you who are at all familiar with the literature know that there is an example of this in Joseph Raz's service conception of practical authority. So this is a kind of very brief and simplified outline of his view. Right, and then I can finally get to what I'm hoping to have. Good. So practical authority, the fundamental intuition that Raz is pumping when he is developing this conception of authority, is that practical authority is really a tool by which we can better comply with the best balance of reasons that we already have. So we're walking around with reasons all over the place, just like that reason about the anvil, right? The anvil's coming, I should get out of its way, even if I don't know it. You have tons and tons of reasons that you're walking around with or sitting there with, right? You have reasons if you're thirsty to take a drink, if you're, you know, trying not to fall asleep to keep your eyes open, whatever it is, you have a reason, you have lots of reasons that you're navigating and you're trying to weigh how much those reasons weigh, how important they are, and figure out what the right thing to do is, right? So practical authority is a tool by which we can better comply with the best balance of those reasons that we already have. And that's why it's called the service conception. It's the service conception because what legitimates authority is when it's correctly acting in the service of those who are subject to it. So what does it mean to say the best balance? Well, as I said, our process of practical reason is to consider the reason, to consider the reasons that we already have. We try to get a good take on what the normative reasons are. We're making our best understanding of what those actual reasons are. We try to give those reasons, those various reasons, their proper weight in our deliberations about what to do, and then determine a course of action based on assessing those reasons and their weights. Right? That's how we decide what to do on a moment-to-moment basis. Maybe it's not always so explicit, maybe you're not always thinking about it so clearly, but that's basically the model of what we're hoping to do when we're acting rationally, right? Yet the very fact that what we're trying to track, what we're trying to get right, are these normative reasons, these objective reasons that we have, and their weights, implies that we can make mistakes. We can make mistakes about what reasons we have. We can make mistakes about what their proper weights are. And the fact that we can make mistakes about them suggests that other people might be in a position to do it better than we can on some occasions. And if other people are in a position to do it better than we can on some occasions, then the need, the desire, the reason that we have to act rationally means that on those occasions when other people can do it better than we can, we now have a good reason to subject our decision-making, our will, our ability to determine, our autonomy, if you will, about how to act to their decision-making when they can do it better than we can. So a legitimate directive is one that directs us to act as we should have determined ourselves if we were aware of all of the relevant reasons and we were giving them their proper weight in our deliberations. Yet the baseline of autonomy that I said before suggests or means that it can only be legitimate when it improves our ability to comply with that best balance of reasons. And where doing so is more important than deciding for ourselves. So there's a catch. Some subjects, and we can talk about some examples, are ones on which it's more important to decide for yourself, even at the risk of making a mistake. So it's not going to apply to everything. There'll be some situations in which it won't apply, right? And those would be ones in which, if they told you what to do, it would not be legitimate. So let's see. As a result of this, what we're hoping is that a legitimately authoritative directive, that's somebody telling you what to do and then actually having a right to tell you, is one that A is based on the reasons that people already have. And those reasons are not necessarily in the person's interest. They could be moral reasons that require the person to make a sacrifice. Right? You can have a reason to sacrifice your life. It could be a moral reason to sacrifice your life, and you may not be aware of it, and somebody else can tell you, or they can make it your moral reason to sacrifice your life by giving you the directive in the right situation. So it's not about interest, these reasons. It's about what reasons you actually have, which can require quite a bit. So A, it must be based on the reasons that we already have. It must better reflect the best balance of those reasons than the person would have been able to arrive at on their own, right? So if you're an expert on the subject, then the directive may not be legitimate for you. That's what makes it partially, what makes it a piecemeal account, right? Raz gives an example of a pharmacologist. The drug laws are arguably not authoritative, legitimately, for a pharmacologist who knows exactly how the drugs will affect him or her, right? Now, there may be other reasons that they are authoritative. If they're going to take the drug in public, and then other people say, hey, the pharmacologist can do it, so I can do it, and that would induce other people to do something that would be dangerous, then maybe when they're in public, it's the directive is legitimate, and when they're in private, it's not legitimate in that types of situation. So it's piecemeal. Depends on what time, what the situation is, who the person is, all of those things. But it does not, what the theory doesn't do is it doesn't reduce practical authority to theoretical authority. It bases it on theoretical authority, a kind of theoretical authority that's expanded to also cover situations where the authority is no more knowledgeable than the person, but is in a better place to make a coordination of, let's say, to solve a coordination problem or something. So the reason it's not a reduction to theoretical authority is that it does give you new reasons to act. It's not giving you simply a reason to believe, it's giving you a new reason to act that you didn't already have. Does that make sense? Understands that? So that's why it's not a reduction, but it does explain why it's piecemeal. And then finally, right, legitimately authoritative directive, based on reasons we already have, better reflects the best balance of reasons than the person could do on their own, is not on a subject that deciding autonomously is more important than getting it right. And I promised you an example of this. Raz's example here is the question of whom you should marry, right? So you might say, well, clearly, it's much more important that somebody marries the person that they choose or that they make the decision themselves and should not be ordered to marry someone. That's very, very important because they're going to spend hopefully the rest of their lives with that person. So even at the risk of making the wrong decision, it's more important that the people make the decision themselves. However, you can imagine, you know, post-apocalyptic sci-fi scenarios where that's not the case, right? Where you have to repopulate the world with some sort of specific gene combination, and maybe the government then has a right to tell you whom to marry, right? So in all the legitimacy of the directive, the situations around you can impact whether or not that's an example that would usually be one that you should have the right to make the mistake, even, you know, it's better to choose for yourself even at the risk of making a mistake, or is there something else that would undermine the fact that it's better to make that decision for yourself? Right, okay. And finally, as I said before, it adds the legitimately authoritative directive, adds to the reasons the person has. The fact that they got the directive, the fact that you've been ordered, is now a new reason for the action that you didn't have before. But it also replaces some of your reasons. When we are confronted with a legitimate directive, it's supposed to exclude acting on any contrary reasons that the authority was meant to take into account when they issued it, right? So you might think, okay, go back to reasoning. There are reasons we have in favor of the action, there are reasons we have against the action. We're trying to decide on our own. Now in comes the authority, they can do a better job than we can, so they're making that weighing on their own. They, in making that, they're already including and considering at least some, if not all, of the reasons against the action that they're gonna tell you to do. So now what happens when they give you a legitimate directive is those reasons that are against the action are excluded by the directive. But if there was some reason that they could not have thought of, right, was not something that they could have considered, then that's not necessarily excluded, and it could be a reason to come back and say, I'm not going to follow the order, right? So you can have an otherwise legitimate directive. Imagine the speed limit, right? Speed limit is drive 70 miles an hour, no more than 70 miles an hour, on the freeway, motorway, what's the word here? the parkway. There's so many different words in America versus the UK for this. The motorway, right? Drive no more than 70 on the motorway. Let's imagine that the rule, for some reason, there was no way for them to consider the exceptions of if you're an emergency vehicle or if you're rushing someone to the hospital. If they hadn't been able to consider those for some reason, then you would have been in a position to use those to say, well, in this case, if I'm rushing someone to the hospital, it's not a legitimate directive for me. It's not a legitimate directive because that's a good reason that the authority didn't consider or couldn't have considered for some reason. And so therefore, I can just break it, right? I'm legitimate. The correct thing to do is to break it. I'm not violating my duty to obey the law if I break the law in that situation because it's a good reason to go over 70 miles an hour. Now, as it happens, they did consider it, and they wrote it in as an exception, so it's not, you're not breaking it if you do make use of it. But you can think of similar situations where they couldn't have considered some new situation, some new exigency that you find yourself in that would be an excuse or a justification, still not sure about which, for breaking the law in those circumstances, right? Okay. So, right. So it adds, it replaces some when we're confronted with a legitimate directive. It's supposed to exclude acting on any contrary reasons that the authority was meant to have considered in issuing that directive. That's why novel or special reasons can still defeat the directive, and that's what gives the directive the character of a duty. This is kind of important, right? The reason it comes to you as a duty is precisely that the way it operates is by excluding some of your reasons. And that's how moral duties operate. When you have a moral duty, forget about one that you've gotten from someone's order, it's supposed to exclude your acting on other reasons you may have not to do it, right? So if you have a moral duty to give to charity in a given instance, that should exclude, let's say, a reason you have to not give that money to charity because you want to take somebody out to dinner or something like that, take your kids out to dinner or something, right? So once you think I have a moral reason, a moral duty to give this money, this particular money to charity, then the reason I have to use that money to take them out to dinner is excluded from my action. I can't act on that reason. I have to act on the moral one. So it seems to be operating in the same way as getting an order from a legitimate authority, right? So it's novel. It's what gives the directive the character of duty. Moral reasons generally exclude acting on other countervailing reasons. To obey the directive is then to follow it because one acknowledges that it's likely doing a better job at weighing your reasons. To merely conform with the directive is to act in accord with it, but only to do so based on your own estimation of the reasons, of all the reasons in play. So you're not actually affording the authority, you're not really affording the directive its authority because you're still making up your mind on your own based on your weighing. So if you do the weighing yourself and then decide, right, regardless of what they're telling you and just using that as another data point, you're merely conforming. But if you just say, okay, they gave me the order, that's what I'm supposed to do, that's obeying. Now, there are a couple of problems with this conception, and my hope is, and I only have a couple of minutes, to outline how I'm going to try to respond to some of these problems. Two quick problems. Sometimes the reason that the directive reflects are moral ones, but often they are not. Often the reasons that the government is giving you are reasons that you already had, let's call them prudential reasons, not moral ones. Prudential reasons about your own safety, about what it would be good for you to do in life, about how to organize your life or go through your projects or something like that. Those aren't necessarily your moral reasons. How does the mere fact that they give you a directive convert these apparently non-moral reasons into moral reasons and give you a duty to comply? That's a problem, right? Now, one answer could be found in the way that the legitimate directive excludes countervailing reasons in the same way as other moral duties, and we can explore that. The other problem is that duties of obedience to authority are generally understood to be owed to someone, possibly to the person who's commanding you, although it's an open question about whether that's necessarily the case. But it doesn't clearly factor in this count how the duty is being owed to anyone outside yourself, right? If they're your reasons that you're already supposed to, if it's helping you to comply better with the best balance of your reasons, then in what sense do you owe it to somebody else to follow the order that you're getting? Now, it's pretty clear that we only sometimes owe it to the person in or body issuing the directive, but in many cases, it's owed elsewhere. Okay, so finally, and then I'll stop talking because I know I should give some talk time for questions, so I'm not going to get through all of this clearly. What my proposal is to do is to examine five areas of practical authority that we come across in daily life. Maybe not everyone's daily life, but at least daily life of someone, right? The idea would be to try to articulate, maybe somewhat theoretically, the legitimacy conditions of the practical authority in those five areas. And then compare them to Raz's theory and see, does Raz's theory do a good job of explaining legitimacy conditions of those five of practical authority in those five areas of life? If not, can we adjust Raz's theory to make it a better account of what's going on with these areas of practical authority? Or do we need to kind of adjust our understanding of what the legitimacy conditions are in those areas? And then finally, to take it back to law and say, how could we use this information that we've got from these five areas to better understand under what conditions the law actually has the right to, or the government has the right to tell you what to do through the law? So the five areas, and I'm not going to go through all of them like in detail because we're completely out of time, but the five areas I propose to study are parental authority, even for adult kids, but certainly for, you know, kids as they get towards adults. It seems as though kids have a duty in some sense to do what their parents tell them. There are more traditional and less traditional understandings of this, right? So if we can understand what the contours are and what legitimates that, would that inform us our understanding of what's going on with Raz's theory? Seems to me that if you have a very traditional understanding of parental authority, the expression of the parent is informing you of their wishes, and you have a pre-existing duty to do what the parent wants you to do. I, of course, confronted this with this very every day because I have three kids from ranging in age from 4 to 9, and so they don't very listen to me very much, and so I keep, you know, going on about parental authority. The other kind, or the second kind, would be military authority. Obviously, very, very, you know, fraught situation when you're confronted with making sacrifices as a member of the military. It's so you're always dealing with moral duties all the time, and it clearly is owed not to the commander, but maybe to your compatriots or other members of the service or something like that. Workplace authority seems like it's not owed to the boss, might be owed to the corporation, perhaps. Maybe there is something more contractual with the authority in the workplace. But it also seems like a situation in which it would be a good microcosm for trying to understand how the personal interests can be converted into moral duties when you're getting an order from, let's say, for someone from your boss in the workplace. The petty official, which I understand to be, you know, cops, police officers, and bureaucrats, these are legal authorities, but they're trying to channel the authority of law into specific directives and actions that you have to do. And that may be, in some ways, you know, they have a general authority and then they're interpreting it on you. And so we can use this as a kind of also microcosm, perhaps to understand more of what's going on when judges are doing something similar and trying to rule in cases that you're involved in. And finally, just one that I happen to be interested in is rabbinic authority. Obviously, it's not, you know, necessarily accessible to everybody in terms of their own personal history. But at the same time, there's a long history of discussion about under what conditions and what gives a rabbi the right to tell people what to do if it's at variance with what's in scripture or something like that. And we have a long tradition of trying to understand what the legitimacy conditions are. And some people, although, you know, have noticed some affinities between theories of rabbinic authority and Raz's theory. Raz wasn't religious, but he did seem maybe to have imbibed some of this, perhaps through osmosis or something like that. So it'd be interesting to try to understand an account of that and give a kind of more Razian. So that's all I have time for. I would love to hear any questions you have. Yeah.
So I was really interested by your discussion of the petty official.
Okay.
And the analogy you drew to judges.
Okay.
And I was wondering how you see the distinction that arises when we consider that judges, especially are doing sort of two things. On one hand, they're applying the rule, but on another, they are contributing to our understanding of what the rule itself means. Mm-hmm. Whereas petty officials, it seems like they're not doing that. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, can you speak to that?
I mean, I think that that's just more of an accident of publicity, potentially. I don't know. I mean, it's from my kind of other perspective, understanding the nature of law, I would say that if the actions of the petty officials are going to be deemed as valid decisions in the legal system, then those are also contributing to our understanding of, of the rule itself in the same way as the judges are. We just don't write it down and then read about it in casebooks. And so it may be a much more localized ability, or much, you know, it's just I mean, I'll give you an example. The great example that comes to mind now is the actions of the police during the coronation in arresting the members of the Republic, right, which is the anti-monarchists here. Now, you might say, well, that seems to have gone beyond the law. Now, in the time and place that they were doing it, they're saying, this is what, you know, this is what the law means, this is how we apply it here, and we can have a debate about whether that's correct, and that'll go to the courts, and then they'll change it, or, you know, and they'll say, that no, that's not what we meant, or that's not what was meant. But in that local space, that's the application and the mean, and the how to flesh out that rule with respect to that. And it was as a result of expanded police powers that were given to the police by Parliament recently. So there's going to be a court case, and that'll help us flesh it out. But they're already doing what the courts are doing in essence by arresting these people before they actually did anything disruptive. Yeah, Alex,
I'm curious about the workplace authority example. This might have to do with the bullet point you didn't talk about: organizational interests undermine legitimacy.
Yeah,
I've had a tough time applying the Razian conception, the service conception, to the workplace authority example. Especially if it's a situation where the organization's interests aren't ones that you have an independent duty to pursue or advance, mm-hmm. right? So you sign up, you sign a contract, you agree to do certain tasks and so on, and that's like generally quite vague. Then you get specific directives from your boss in order to further organizational interests.
Yeah.
In what sense do they have sort of Razian authority over you if you don't have reason to pursue those organizational interest necessary? You agreed to something very general in your contract,
right.
But suppose this goes beyond that, or is at least much more specific than that. And so it doesn't seem like in that case you're right following the directive is going to help you better conform to your reason. So I'm just curious, walk me through how your workplace.
So it's harder to articulate how that comes out as a moral reason, but I can definitely do it in the Razian flavor.
Uh-huh.
I don't think there's a, because I can say on the one hand you may not have agreed to anything that specific in your contract.
Uh-huh.
But at the same time, by signing on to become a member of this organization, you are adopting its, in some ways, its success is part of your interest-based reasons.
Mm-hmm.
So you have an interest in it succeeding. Because if it goes under, then you need to look for another job, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you now have an interest in it succeeding, and your own interest in it succeeding becomes a reason for you that's an accurate reflection of, you know, its success conditions or something like that. And you may not be aware of what those are because those people are in a better coordinating position than you are. So I think that's still a Razian kind of answer.
Yeah, interesting. Cool.
Yeah.
Thanks, Ken. That was great. Is there a reason why the examples you've chosen, they all have like a vertical flavor to them, you know? And so, you know, one common way of trying to put pressure on the service conception is to think of forms of authority which have a sort of horizontal flavor to them, like democratic authority or authorities where the person who's doing the ordering is in some sense chosen. And so, I'm wondering, you know...
Why wouldn't the emergency room jumping up on the table be like an example of that?
Mm-hmm.
Where you have the original, where the room with you mean my five areas?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh,
these five areas. Yeah, they all have sort of vertical flavor to them, right? And
that's a good question. I think I need to think about that some more. My initial reaction to that is to say that I'm trying to understand the legitimacy conditions of authority where we come across it in daily life, and we're much more likely to come across vertical authority as authority than we are to come across some sort of horizontal authority. I mean, the only horizontal authority I can think of is more this example of a guy jumping up to coordinate in an emergency or something like that. And that's not something we're going to confront in a kind of very frequent way. So what you seem to be suggesting about horizontal authority, and I have to think more about what you mean by democratic, because when we do democratic authority, if we're not talking about ancient Athens, we're still elevating some people to give us orders over us. So we're not talking about just my next door neighbor can come over and start ordering me. So when you think about horizontal authority in those circumstances, it's harder to think of instances where we have a common experience of a horizontal legitimate authority.
Yeah, I mean, the vertical horizontal thing is just a metaphor, right? It
yeah.
just seems like Yeah. Chosen authority seems to be a distinct example from your examples.
I mean, okay, so I'm looking for ones that are, I expect the theory to be one that would be, I think one of the desiderata of the theory is that it's non-voluntarist.
Yeah.
And so that's part of what's going on here. There is a flavor, an aspect of rabbinical authority that is still chosen in the way that you do. After the destruction of the temple, for example, then there's the rise of the ability, the belief that people are, in a sense, having to choose for themselves to accept the yoke of rabbinic authority, as it were. So there is a kind of more voluntarist aspect of that one, I suppose. You could argue something similar with the military if you're not dealing with a draft. So that would also be a potential one. Yeah. And workplace also. I mean, you know, maybe you're independently wealthy. You don't necessarily need a job, right? Yeah.
This may be a stupid question because, as you know, I'm not a philosopher.
No stupid questions, only stupid answers.
And I'm not familiar with Raz. But what is it that makes Raz's argument more than a simple heuristic? You know, I've delegated, in effect, to somebody the ability to put together all the different reasons that I'm too busy to put together.
Right.
I mean, is that his legitimation?
Yeah, that's a really good question. It's not a heuristic because, well, first of all, we're not delegating, right? So the person who jumps up on the table did not get any delegated authority. They just have it because they're solving the problem. And we can say in many of these instances, you know, we're not delegating our authority to our parents. We may, to some extent, but not a large extent, in the military. Probably are, to some extent, in the workplace. Petty official, it depends on the legal system. Rabbinic, probably not the delegator. So, I mean, is it just a heuristic for understanding authority? In some sense, it's a theory of what legitimates it. So you could understand that as a kind of heuristic. To try to say, well, this is what we mean when we talk about legitimate authority. But that's more of a question about what's the nature of a theory. Right? So is the theory just a heuristic for understanding what we already are doing? Maybe, but that's also part of what we're doing when we're trying to come up with certain kinds of theories in philosophy, is to kind of unpack the practice and see, well, what are we really doing? Right? So maybe we're discovering more through this, and it's not just, as you put it, a heuristic. Does that answer your question? Sort of, yes, sort of, no?
Sort of.
You're right.
Yeah, great. So so we're trying to figure out when someone is able to give you a reason that wasn't there. And
right.
You've mentioned now a couple of times that this paradigm example that you think helps us think about this is the emergency case.
Yeah.
And I want to do what you did in the parental case to see if the emergency case isn't a good example. In which we get reasons that we didn't have before. So you said on a traditional understanding of parenting, it's possible that what's happening is you have a reason, pre-existing parental authority, to do what your parents want.
Yeah.
And then when your parents want something, that just sort of fills in the details of what your kind of duty is. So now I have to do this because that's
so how are they giving you a new reason then?
So in the emergency case, presumably we all have a reason to do whatever will contribute to getting rid of the emergency situation.
Absolutely.
To make things better.
Good.
And then when someone gets up and yells, there's the exit, what happens is it becomes much more likely that there's a way out.
Sure.
And so maybe that's, I mean, maybe one way of thinking about it is they haven't actually given me a new reason, but they've changed the sort of facts that trigger the existing reasons and tell me what to do. So is that a good explanation of the emergency case?
Without getting into very, you know, long-winded dispute with Enoch, whom you've just invoked without realizing it. The problem with that view is that implies that you kind of had, that all of your reasons are in some sense pre-existing, and they're just triggered or funneled, as it were, by all of these things that are going on. And there are kind of problems with that view. It's not an untenable view. It's just that you have to agree that, you know, like, you're born with every reason you ever had, and that everything's just going around triggering everything. And it seems, I mean, we could get into reasons for believing this, but it seems as though you could change these situations so that they're more and more attenuated, right? So I think a better way of understanding, let's say, the parental one, is to say you have a pre-existing reason to honor your parents and make them happy, but that does not extend to any given action until you're ordered. And so the reason, the normativity that you have is now attached to that action that it wasn't there before. And the ability to attach the action to that new, the normativity to that new action, that's what you're getting that's new. And that seems to be at least one way of explaining why it's a new reason to do something. You didn't have a reason to take out, maybe you did have a reason to take out the garbage, but you didn't have a reason to be quiet when your parent said, be quiet, until your parent actually said it, right? Your reason for like, let's play and make a lot of noise. Because you didn't know that was something, there was no way of knowing that would be something that would, upset your parent. Josh.
I'm stuck back on the reasons and autonomy bit.
Good.
And I think this might have some implications for the authority bit.
Yeah.
But I'm wondering if you have or you need to have an answer to somebody, a skeptic, let's call them, who thinks, let's look at your animal example or let's look at your marriage example, and thinks, well, there's no matter of fact about what reasons you have in
right.
either case. It could be that you should take the animal because humans are horrible creatures that just pollute and kill them. And it could be that marriage is much more successful when you're told who to marry and don't have all these stupid fantasies about meeting your soulmate and all
right.
that. Other things. So,
Or
it could be the opposite, and we just don't know.
Right.
Right. So, and I think we could just tell the story pretty much
everything.
Sure. Right? So everything becomes a conditional or a hypothetical reason.
Whoa. All what you've told me so far is that we don't have epistemic access. We can't know for sure whether we're right or wrong about any given reason.
Okay,
that
so
doesn't mean that it's all...
A suppressed premise.
Yeah.
So what the answer will be to the reason you have in any given situation will depend on whatever values you subscribe to, whatever values you elevate. So if you elevate thinking you've made this choice, to find your soulmate above being told what to do, then that will give you... one direction. If you value your self-preservation over what's better for the universe, then you'll step out of the way of the animal.
So that, just to push up against that one.
Yeah.
I'm not denying that a lot will depend on the values that you've chosen, but part, I believe, of practical reason is also that there are better and worse choices about which values to adopt. So there might be right answers about those too. And we're trying our best to track
that. Reasons go all the way down. You never hit
down to the
bit
past the turtle.
Value choices.
Past the turtle.
Okay, so we have a fundamentally different...
it's not... There are value choices, and there are going to be spaces for those value choices, and some of it will be hitched to that. I'm not denying that. And those value choices are going to depend a lot on people's background, people's talents, where they're from. All of those things are going to be factors in their value choices, and we need a kind of diversity of at a certain level of value, in order, for a million reasons, if nothing else, so that we have lots of experiments of living and everyone else can see how all these different values work and we can choose which values we want to adopt and stuff. But we also, underneath it, there are values that are supposedly common or should be common and that we have the best, the best package of values that I can adopt given all of those factors about myself, including something that's universal to humans, something that's just me because of my particular background and genetic makeup, and some things that are in between, cultural history, et cetera, et cetera. And so there are going to be best choices about all of those things. Veronica wanted to get in on this exactly.
Yeah, very quickly.
Yeah.
So it is about values, right?
That's going to be part of it.
That's going to be part of it. So in your exposition, you didn't mention the exclusionary property. That actually the reasons is that the concession is an exclusionary.
So
what about if what the authority does is actually tapping into the values you already have?
Yeah, so this was the part that was supposed to be talking about the exclusionary property there?
So my question is basically, how would you justify the exclusionary property?
So Raz's way, right? So Raz's way to justify the exclusionary property, and I'm not just going to retreat to Raz, but Raz's way to say that that's the only way that the authority is understood to be a tool, and the only way it can do its job as that tool is to exclude and replace the countervailing reasons.
Yeah, I understand that, but why if there is a power of the value, and the authority can tap into the value. For example, in your example of emergency food, we tap all into the value of survival.
Yeah. So why is that creating a problem for exclusion? I don't see the problem for exclusion there.
Yeah, because according to Raz, the normative reason or the exclusionary reason excludes your first order reasons. But it, it,
right.
what happens when the first order reasons are perfectly compatible because the agent is perfectly rational, so then, has engaged with rationality.
Good, excellent. So two answers depending on the situation. In one situation, you're already perfectly assessing all of the reasons, and in the case where you're perfectly assessing all the reasons, the order is illegitimate. So it's not legitimate at all because you've already perfectly got all the reasons. In the other situation, right, the order is legitimate because it's better at, you know, potentially reflecting the reasons that you've already somewhat subscribed to and otherwise have. So in the case of the emergency room, you know, you ought to value life over whatever else is that making you, you know, you ought to value coordination and whatever about the emergency. And therefore, you know, it's correctly capturing that. If it's correctly capturing that better than you are, then it's excluding your countervailing reasons, not the ones you have in favor of the action. It only excludes the ones you have against the action that's telling you to do. And so any values that you have are pushing you towards against the action that you're being ordered to do, those, if they're meant to be considered by the authority, are excluded, and that's in order for it to do its job. And the other option is it's not legitimate because
but
you already got it.
You always have to reason then.
Of course you always have to reason. Raz's picture does not deny that you always have to reason, you always have to decide on your own.
Sure.
That's a mistake I think people make about Raz's picture, is that, oh, well, you're replacing your reasoning. You're not replacing your reasoning. He doesn't deny the unescapability of autonomy. Right? No one's denying that you have autonomy and you can't escape that autonomy. You always must make the decision on your own. The point is to recognize that sometimes someone telling you what to do is actually helping you, and that you should do what they tell you to do because they're in a better position to know what you want to do than you are. Right? I just wanted to get one more question. You want to?
It's just on this time point. Just isn't there a third category of like partial exclusion where the values would say, do it because you're told to, but also consider some of the reasons for yourself and reinforce it, and that'll provide the best sort of...
Right.
So I have to think of what an example might be, but it seems like the two cases you gave in response to Veronica allow for a third category, which I think is kind of what you might be getting at. And so it just seems like you'd have to evaluate the degree of exclusion that would come in every specific case based on the value. So now you're like back into the business of a lot of first order reasoning.
So there is a lot of risk that you're going to go back to first order reasoning, and that is a problem. But I think in the case that you're explaining, the way you've explained it, back up and say what?
Just partial exclusion.
Right. So that sounds to me like closer to what we might call mere compliance.
Mm-hmm.
Rather than obedience, right? So if you're in a situation, you get the order, you can, one choice would be to say, legitimate authority, that's what I ought to do. The other choice is, okay, now I got this information, this supposedly legitimate authority, maybe I'm not sure they're legitimate, is giving me an order, I have to decide, you know, how do I treat that? Am I gonna treat it by excluding, or am I gonna add it to my list? Now, there's problems with adding it, because you might be double counting some things, so you can't simply add it to your weighing, because they're already weighing the reasons that they think you have.
Mm-hmm.
So you can't simply put it on the scale, but it is in some sense another reason. And so when you do the compliance, right, if it wasn't already a legitimate authority, then the right thing to do is still to just decide on your own and to comply. And that means treating it as, in a sense, you're just getting information about, well, that guy wants me to do this, right?
Mm-hmm.
Let's ignore what it says about my underlying reasons and just say, okay, another reason is that guy wants me to do it, right? So that's not to treat it as a legitimate authority, but you may still end up following what they tell you to do. Right. Sorry, Renee.
Yes, well, great then. And I was fascinated by the survey, these different conceptions of authority.
Thought you might like that.
Yeah, well, and even bringing in Plato or the Crito, if you like, and formulating in terms of gratitude, which is nice. I was actually wondering whether, and if so, how Weber's conception of authority would fit in as charisma.
Right. So I would put Weber's conception in the power category. I don't know. I did audit some classes on Weber with what was her name at Columbia in political theory. Oh man, it's all good my time. So I audited a couple classes on Weber when I was in grad school. So I can't pretend to know it very well. But my memory and being jogged somewhat by thinking about things like charisma makes me think that that's more on either the de facto or the power conception. So if someone has charisma, is like they have the power over you, I know you're resisting this, or you have a belief, they have an ability to cause a belief in you that they have a right to tell you what to do. So let's put aside, You know, so that could be the power, or it could be also your belief. So it's about psychological states that are affected by that charisma. The charisma, now Weber, if he's saying that you get a right to tell people what to do merely because you have that charisma, I think that that's a little bit, I probably wouldn't agree with that, and I would think that's a little bit misleading because it seems to, it's the closest it looks like is by, it would be an inference from power of right. You know, so kind of, you know, I mean, maybe I'm making a too Nietzschean a gloss on Weber here, but that's what it looks like it's doing. Any final questions? Yeah. Yeah.
Is it the role of the parent, or is it parent to child in that sort of as child increases in competency, as the parental expectation, as the child becomes responsible for that?
That's clearly an aspect of it. I do think it's role related, but I also think it's relational. So other people can fill that, if you will, role, and I guess that still makes it a role, but maybe it's not an official role. So if someone's in the right relation, then they may get some of that parental authority. I do think it changes as the child grows up, but I also think there's something to be said for our kind of more traditional view that even as an adult, we have very strong reasons to still obey our parents, if I can use the word obey even, but that the areas of their legitimacy shrinks as we get older. So fewer and fewer of the things that they could potentially order you to do are things that you could still do. Now, it may still be that my traditional view is one that still gives it a very large area that they would have. But certainly, you know, I mean, most likely if I'm in grad school and my parent calls me and says, do your homework, right? I don't have the same kind of, I don't have the same kind of reasons to do what they're telling me to do as I would if I was still in high school or before. So I think something is changing there because maybe when I'm in grad school, I'm like, well, I can't just drop everything and do my homework. There might be something else that's going on that they're not aware of right then. Whereas when I'm in high school, maybe I have more of a reason to drop everything. And that's what I'm trying to instill in my kids right now. It seems like the hardest thing for me, for some reason, is that when I give them a directive, they're supposed to drop everything and do what I'm telling them, and it does not sink in. I don't know how that sinks in. If anyone has any ideas, I keep telling them, when I tell you to do something, you drop what you're doing and you go do it. You don't finish what you want.
It's good that they are totally
Right, well, that's right. I don't have the Weberian charisma. It's my rejection of the Weberian charisma that's undermining my authority. Yeah, for sure. Okay, it's probably about time, right? Thanks. Thanks very much for coming. I'm happy to chat further or to accept any other ideas you might have by email. You can find me on the law school website.